Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
So this is very prevailing discussion that we want to put it together for privacy. And because we all had gone through the GDPR, right? So all of us were worried and had been working and had been understanding and probably trying to comply with the the requirement of GDPR. And there are various different set of organizations which have been struggling, grappling in terms of what needs to be done for the GDPR compliances. And there are some mad reactions also that we have seen, right? Some of those organizations I have seen, they even closed viewing of the their websites by European citizens. So people have gone to that extent. And then we also got a lot of those mails seeking our consent, and sometimes those mails has been even challenged and ridiculed by many of the professionals as well. So the privacy as a subject, it's not only GDPR now, it's a catching up all across globe actually. Our Indian government has also come up with a white paper last year. Some of you must have seen that white paper, and it also now trying to look at various aspects that will be taken, that should be taken into consideration to define national privacy policies or national privacy approach, or that translate into a larger data protection regulation in the country. So we all know that as a Data Security Council of India, so we engage with almost 3-4 different dimensions of the subject matters of subject of a privacy. So one of the important dimension is primarily the lawmaking and policy making. So various different government institutions have been working together. Now the Minister of IT is now seems to be very key leader or key driver for setting up this committee, as well as it will be also coming up with a data protection draft law, and we are expecting that draft to be coming in a coming few years time, probably hardly in this month or next month basically. So that is one which is happening, and since DSCI's inception in 2008, where 2008 was also very important area, an important year for us, because that is how we amended our data IT Act, and this IT Act brought some level of data protection regime in the country. You all know that Section 43 of IT Act talked about data protection in this country. It talks about reasonable security practices needs to be implemented for the purpose of data protection, and very, very limited sense it brought a data protection regulation or regime in this country. But then during last 7 years of time, the discussion of privacy had been evolving and shaping so many things around the globe and in India as well. Especially in last 6 months, 7 months of the in this country, some of the political application as well, some of those larger application that we had been looking at in terms of larger Indian government's intervention to solve the problem of identity, and we have that application and we have those identity, and that also triggered a lot of debate and discussion about the privacy. To even one politician's applications was challenged because data is going out of the country in some other geography. So a lot of those discussions have been happening. And then this Cambridge Analytica happened, and then we have been started challenging the way the data is being collected, processed by the global platforms as well. And entire this platform technology and platformization of security, that the theme that we put together, it also, one of the important part of platformization is compiling the experiences of the people, experience of the organization, and then using those experiences may have a lot of personal information, and that could be a very specific identifiable information of a person, or it could be opinion, views, or beliefs of the person as well. So a lot of those discussion had been shaping the domain of privacy. And then in that shaping of the privacy discussion, there are various different kind of approaches that do had been evolving all across globe. So one of the very important approach basically we talk about, there are three primary approach basically. So one is very liberal approach to the subject of privacy. For example, in case of US, it talks about a kind of a problem solution driven approach, and avoiding creating one stringent data protection regulation. And that is how, in a way, it also asks, or it also allows the organization to take some risks. So to the extent that it shouldn't harm the individual. So preventing harm is a principle there. And that's what the US geography is. It talks about if there's a problem, you try to find a solution for that problem rather than creating one larger regulation as we see in case of GDPR, right? So GDPR is now one regulation at the European level, and each of the organization which is in business of collecting and processing personal information has to comply with one regulation. So this is approach that the European Union talks about. So, and the approach this of European Union is primarily driven out of the privacy as a fundamental right. Right, so you equate privacy as a fundamental right, and that's why the entire baseline of privacy protection significantly enhances because of that. And all the data protection regulatory initiative in European Union flows out of that one. And that's why it tries to limit the way the organizations are collecting information. It tries to limit the way the informations are being processed. It also tries to limit the way the information can be shared, can be transferred from the geography of EU to other geography as well. So that's the second approach. In case of US, it's very liberal problem solution driven approach. So if there is a problem with the health information, you are HIPAA. If there's a problem with the financial information, there is GLBA. So that approach is very liberal in the sense. And we see that approach is really helping entire this internet social media innovation. We see that geography is quite leading, which probably allows them to probably freely use the personal information and work on those information. And all the digitization innovation that we see, or social innovation that we see, that comes from that geography. While technologically, European Union may be very much leading, but we don't see that happening, those kind of innovation happening in European Union. And that is what the characteristically the regulation, the way they shapes the entire the ecosystem in those country and entire innovation ecosystem in those country as well. So use of data, or collection and use of data, had been challenged a lot all across the globe. And every country has been responding to that challenge, and that is, those responses are happening because it is to deal with the harm that it goes to the individual, and it is to deal with the purpose that you collected for that information. And somebody would like to equate that to the fundamental privacy law. And in this country, last year in August, basically, Supreme Court has awarded us privacy as a fundamental right. So means now we probably are going in a way the European Union had gone in terms of their privacy evolution. Probably our privacy regime should be at significantly higher level as probably we see in the case of European Union. And that is what the data protection regulation last year has put up that paper, basically. And when that paper was put, basically, that paper had talked about all of those things that could go potentially into the data protection regulation of this country. And we can discuss those elements as a part of this particularly prevailing town hall that we are looking at. And then when we are discussing that, probably we should also reflect on some of the challenges of this entire social internet economy, look at investigating them, critically examining them, and at the same time look at what exactly it is entailing to the businesses like us, how it is impacting our businesses, how it is putting a lot of pressure on our businesses, and how it can potentially impact the overall startup and innovation economy that we are seeing in this country. So that is also one important thing that we should probably try to investigate or examine as a part of this discussion. And then we can also look at, there are some political policy issues that do come out of this interaction. And one way of looking at is to how to then ensure these larger players like internet platform providers, as we have seen, European Union has asked CEO of Facebook to come and give the testimony. So how exactly we can extend the reach of the privacy protection going beyond our boundary is definitely one of the important critical political policy specific issue that needs to be discussed. Another part is how exactly the data, so this is another important thing which comes from the country like India. Until now, the data was being imported by this country. For example, all of those services, BPO, call center, we all have been operating to the global client, and primarily we have been working on their data, right? Either we are accessing data or we are working on their data. So until now, the role of this country was largely importing the information, or we remain a kind of data importer. But that role is changing, right? So we are talking about this country become a digitized. So this country is now becoming data rich country. We are talking about digitization as a very important push in this country. We are talking about $1 trillion digital economy. So that is also, and then because of that, what is happening, our entire transaction exchanges are getting digitally recorded. And then as a 1 billion plus population, we are creating, or you will be creating, tremendous amount of information. And that information would be our power as a country. So can we then use this power really to define the way the technical innovation ecosystem would be there in the future? How can then we deal with this power, with all those technology import that we have been doing? So what is the change that this country will see from the data, until now data importer, but we are transitioning to data exporter because of digitization and because of all of those things that we have been trying to do. So what are those policies, what are those issues that we need to be grappling with when you are talking about countries' role changing from the importer to the exporter? And then what that entails in terms of sovereignty of data. In the morning, there are some people which were part of the discussion. People talk about data sovereignty. People talk about data imperialism. People talk about data monopolies, basically. So what are those concepts, basically? How those concepts are converging and probably conflicting this entire discussion of privacy? And then look at that, but in all of those discussions, GDPR becomes an important discussion, right? And GDPR preparedness becomes an important discussion as well. So while discussing all of these things, we also try to work on what exactly we are doing, where we stand in terms of GDPR, where we as a country stand in terms of preparing against GDPR requirement. So there is some survey that we try to put up together with the help of Dulight. So we'll also try to present those result of the survey. During the course, we'll also discuss about entire GDPR and its impact on largely Indian industry, Indian economy, and entire ecosystem that we have been dealing with. But before we go for the formal discussion or presentation that we may have, with this context, I would like to hear from you. So what do you think? How do you think that privacy is a subject? Where you see that subject is coming in and where exactly it is impacting us as an individual, as a society, and as an enterprise as well. And based on those discussions, probably we'll try to move this discussion forward. Anybody? So what do you think about privacy when you think about privacy and where exactly you think the current evolutions are happening around the data privacy? It's a very freewheeling, open town hall discussion. So please feel free to talk to anything that comes to your mind.
Somebody said something. Aadhaar, okay, good.
So yeah, when we say privacy, probably Aadhaar really helped sometimes people say that you should make people aware. But in the case of privacy, some instances, some applications, some efforts really create awareness about that subject, right? So Aadhaar is definitely very important, central part of the privacy discussion in this country. Okay, that is one part. Yeah, if there is something which goes wrong, and what will be the implication of that to one as a company, but it also creates a lot of question mark on overall industry, right? So if anything goes wrong with one company, that creates a lot of question mark on the other companies and on entire industry as well. So that's very definitely important part. Any other thing?
Okay, good.
Yeah, that's also very important part because the entire concept of privacy has now moved from the principle-based implementation of privacy to look at data subjects' rights. So data subjects' participation in the entire process of collecting and processing information becomes important, and this expectation of data subject's right basically had now been very well articulated by right to be forgotten, right to be portability, right to access, right to be erasure, those kind of new principles, and which are primarily data subjects access and data subjects rights basically, and that is a new key addition to the GDPR's overall content of privacy regulation. So privacy regulation is primarily two things, right? So one is the content of regulation, another is the enforcement of those regulation. So now content is definitely significantly talking about what exactly rights of data subject is. And that ties also back to the larger right that you agreed as a privacy as a fundamental right in the country. And that's why subject rights becomes an important part. Yes, that is an important part. Yes, Tarun.
So obviously, privacy as from an enterprise perspective,
privacy seems to have a negative connotation. It's about compliance, it's about cost spending, it's about penalties, it's about things you have to do, right? Hmm. Can it move beyond to become privacy as a differentiator? Can privacy be the reason why you are successful in the market? Can you create a mark and can you be the thought leader in that? I would love to have that
Yeah, that's a very important direction. I mean, GDPR definitely had tried to make people think in that direction. So there was something called as a privacy by design or privacy by default. So those are the interesting ideas GDPR has also brought to the table, to the content of regulation, where it is expecting that when organizations are building systems and solution and product, they should think about privacy by design. But that's only concept. But how exactly you change the paradigm, you change the way you think about privacy from the... So when you talk about privacy, you talk about two things basically. One important thing that you talk about is the bottom line it is hitting. So all these compliance requirement, all of those processes you need to implement, it is really challenging the bottom line of the organization. You need to put lot of investment, you need to lot of people to work on that one. And at the same time, it will also create a lot of scare, because if you are not, so entire liabilities of privacy are like procedural liability as well as outcome-based liability, right? So if you are not able to show that you have not taken a consent, that itself is a lapse. And if there is a breach, that is also big lapse and liabilities on both of those things. So there is a lot of discussion which happens on the compliance side. And there is a other discussion which happens that it doesn't allow you to do anything. So our top line, our innovation, our new experimentation are getting impacted because of privacy. And then people cry and people raise a concern about privacy, because of privacy, we are really constrained to not to do anything. So how can we change the discussion about feeling bad and feeling uncomfortable, feeling constrained about privacy, to look at how exactly we can move the discussion forward in terms of enabling or using our privacy as a challenge to do something which is in a very positive sense, to take privacy as a differentiator, take privacy as a something that you want to really establish your brand. So privacy can help you to establish your brand. So this is also a very important direction the discussion can go on, implementation of privacy can go. Any other thing? Yes. We'll go there first and I'll come to you.
The question is that subject consent is taken for processing data. So I think in GDPR also it is there. But some kind of a guidelines has to be, baselines has to be defined for that, because consent is taken for many things and data is processed inappropriately. So some baseline has to be worked out, because India, we have a large population which does not understand data security requirements and other things. So some baselines has to be defined.
So this is an important part. So consent is notified as a requirement, and there are some standards which are defined under that requirement, right? So for example, there is definitely some standard. Okay, consent should be positive, it's a positive action driven, it should be explicit, and it should be something taken in a very positive sense. So this is a standard. But when these standards are there, how exactly it can be taken for implementation? So what should we take this standard to implement that particular expectation of privacy? So that is where a lot of effort can be looked at in terms of creating best practices or looking at the technology way of implementing thing or doing some kind of process model for that. So for professions which are in privacy, they have a lot of those kind of interesting avenues in terms of consulting, in terms of developing technology modeling, in terms of developing process modeling. And those discussion could be a very important discussion, taking these challenges for implementation organization ecosystem. And what should we do together and learn from each other in terms of implementing privacy in there. So this is a definitely very important dimension.
One more thing. Now, due to GDPR regulations, hacker can take advantage of it. Like now they can ask for some, they will say, we can leak user credentials publicly and can blackmail organizations.
No, what is that?
Like now hackers, rather than leaking user credentials publicly, they can blackmail organizations. Like if they blackmail, they company need to pay 4% GDPR.
You are saying that once people are empowered because of so much of fine, so much of liability, people can use that tool to take action on organization. Definitely, that is a misuse of the power empowerment given to the organizations and other bodies. That is a definitely important part in our data protection regulation. The kind of enforcement mechanism you are trying to create, that enforcement mechanism is another bureaucratic mechanism, and that may be misused by somebody by just raising the fake kind of a complaint, and that could be one of the very important part in, because millions of the organization collect and process information millions of way. And then there are definitely various different means to harass an organization, harass an individual. and privacy may add to one dimension to that harassment. So this is definitely an important point that you raised.
I think Shivangi had a question.
Yeah.
I think one more aspect that we should probably discuss is the actual applicability of GDPR itself. There's a lot of confusion around, how and when does it apply in the case of Indian companies. And applicability also from the point of view that it's not just whether you're selling a service or product to a European person who's on European soil, but also if you're just tracking them or, you know, doing any kind of outreach activity. So maybe if you could talk a little bit.
Yeah, so, and this stems from the expectation of privacy, which are now crossing the borders, right? So the liabilities of privacy or expectation of privacy are now extraterritorial. So
I would word it a bit different. I would say that it's a nation protecting its citizens, now extending that protection to different geographies.
Yeah.
And how does that come into play? And how does the enforcement can really be carried out in this scenario?
Yeah. Because processing is a global phenomena, and data processing can happen any part of the globe. And whatever right that you want to give, in case of India, now privacy is a fundamental right. If you are to protect that right, it can go beyond, because data processing happens beyond the border as well. So how exactly you give the protection beyond the border? And because of that, GDPR did something, and that is why somebody which is doing something for European resident has to think about the applicability of the GDPR requirement. Yes, that is a...
So when it is coming to the privacy, as Supreme Court very clearly given the verdict of the fundamental rights or interpreted the Constitution again. So with that, if it is a fundamental right and all Indian citizens are protected under IPC, so it's a by default extraterritorial effect of the law and it will go to all Indian passport holder to any country.
So I think we
and the privacy law which we are expecting, it is not going to overrule the fundamental rights because it cannot be done. So the new law expected to be having the extraterritorial effect the way our IT law is having currently. So that is one of the areas. Yeah. Another thing is that privacy is a fundamental right, but privacy is not rooted fundamentally in our culture. When it is coming to Indian culture or think in some area, we are very open. So ecosystem, that is the industrial ecosystem, which is going to forcefully impose the privacy in that way, how it will be very challenging to drive it to a positive note. So and
I think,
there should be a
can you bring the volume down a bit?
Yeah.
It's a bit much. Yeah, I think we can take this point and have an open discussion among us about does India actually have a culture of privacy or not?
Not.
Yeah.
Because every forum we go to, every workshop we do, people do ask us, do we as a society have a culture of privacy? Because many people say that we like to, because whenever this example comes up a lot, that you come up and you sit next to somebody and next thing I know, I'm telling everything about my life. It might be true for some people who are of a talkative nature, but just because I like to share doesn't mean that I don't respect my privacy.
So
this desire to share and get to know somebody should not be equated to my private life.
Correct.
So there might be instances where I respect my privacy and I don't want to share that with you. And I should have the right to protect and to exclude somebody from knowing that about my life.
So privacy is something. It's willingness of the dissemination of the information by the person, right?
Sure.
The challenge coming to the industry, what defined under the law as a personal sensitive data, in Indian context, people are generally very, frequently keep sharing those data with the different collection agency of the industry without knowing that this is protected under law. That is throwing more challenges.
Yeah, so I think one of the important discussion which ties back to some of those studies that people do. Like, there is something called individualism index, IDV index that people capture for a country, for a society. So what people say is that more the IDV is, more people will be worried about their privacy. So India being a, until now we are a collectivistic society. I hope everybody understands what is collectivistic society. It's a society where we usually live in a collective family, right? It's a joint family structure that we all live. And that joint family structure tends us to believe people that are in our family. And even because of collectivistic nature of the Indian culture, we tend to believe the organization, those who are collecting and processing information. So, and then that is because IDV index and people connect the IDV index with a privacy relation people try to establish. But increasingly, Indian's IDV index is also significantly rising. We are becoming more nuclear family. We are becoming more aware about what is going wrong with our data, right? And we are increasingly expressing all those concerns as well. So for example, 10 years back, we were looking at the interest of the Indian IT BPO companies in European Union, and European Union used to say that your data protection regulation is not competent enough for us to say that India is data advocate country, right? If that is true, because but that time we may not be thinking to have very comprehensive legislation. But in last 2-3 years of time, you can just imagine what is happening in this country. The what are a lot of those political social discussion happening in this country. So this entire discussion about the Aadhaar or any other application has been really causing a lot in terms of the privacy discussion in this country. So gradually the privacy as a subject and different subject matters of privacy has been touching us. Yeah. And we have been getting aware to that one. It's not only because of the we are becoming a part of global economy, that's also a very important angle of privacy legislation. So trade is now increasingly becoming digital, right? So exchange of data will be very much important for goods and services to be transferred.
Before we move ahead to the trade argument, I mean, I wanted to come back to the cultural aspects of privacy and discuss them a bit further. Does anybody have a different submission on the matter? I mean,
I think we can even take a vote on this part. Culturally, is it like a India's privacy awareness or privacy culturally as a country, our expectation of privacy can't be really matched to the expectation of privacy in European Union, because European Union has gone through all of those problems, right? So because of the way they collected data and used that data to filter out those population and kill that population basically for the large scale. So European Union and the Western culture has gone to a particular experience, and that's why they have this privacy aware culture, and that's why they have been coming up with very stringent, strong global regulation. Against that, do you think that our culture require a very strong, stringent privacy legislation?
Another thing that comes up here is privacy individualistic, or is it a cultural ethos? What are your comments on that? Is it something very personal to an individual? Or do we look at privacy as a collective phenomenon or not?
Yeah, this is also a very important discussion. So do we see privacy as an individual or individual specific shape, or do we see privacy as a overall society and collective interest of the society needs to be protected? Yeah. You just remain, one of you remain here and one of two.
Yeah. In India, I think it is more of a collective thing. But I also feel we somewhat lack appreciation for privacy. But we have another characteristic that wherever we benefit, we are okay with giving away a little bit of our privacy. For example, the Truecaller, we know that our contact list is being shared and is used as a bit of a database.
Yeah.
But as long as I'm getting a benefit without any charge, that I know that whoever is calling me, I get to see the name, I'm fine with it. Similarly, but in the past, like I'm examining myself, say 2-3 years back, any store I would go, they would say, can you give me your mobile number? I would give it. Now I will hesitate to give it. I don't want messages coming from them. But probably if they say, we'll give you a 20% discount, I might weigh it against it and give it. So I also see is we are maturing as a society and we are increasing our appreciation for privacy, but we have that in the back of our mind if we have some benefit and it outweighs the cost of forfeiting little bit of our privacy, we'll go for it.
And this is a very important argument, right? So we all are getting benefited by all of those applications. That is an important dimension. Okay? And all of those applications are free, and that's why we trade our privacy with those facilities that we get. Yes.
See, my take is that privacy, when you speak, in India, getting redressal of other rights, the general rights, anything, leave aside privacy. Privacy is something which has come up today. That itself is a difficult task. Hmm. For a common man, it's a very difficult task.
Yeah.
Privacy to aaj ki baat hai, it has come today. So, when you compare especially to Western Europe and United States, there the legal system is very strong, your rights are redressed pretty fast. So if we have that basic infra in place, I don't know, the whole take on privacy might change. Hmm. The rights to privacy might change. Hmm. Now we have a casual approach. Today I have become a data. Today I am talking these things. But till yesterday, my basic rights, I would think, why get into this mess? It's a mess. So it's more of a enforcement angle I would look to. If that is better, I think privacy would improve.
I think another element that I see here is if we go down further in this, I see few arguments. I mean, is privacy for everybody, or is it just an elitist construct as everybody talks about? It is just confined to these spaces and us people who might know something about it. Do people on the ground level really care? I mean, like you mentioned, there are certain other rights which have not been addressed. Their concerns may be different. But if you were to inform an individual, these are the implications. This is what is there. There is redressal and these things could happen to you. I guarantee they will care. But so that we see where the whole digital divide and the awareness argument comes into the picture.
So there are some assumptions built into that.
Yeah, so, please.
So to respond to your question, you are building some assumptions. Okay, if we make them aware and other things.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely there would be a change.
Hmm.
We saw the latest episode about Facebook and the whole thing. There would be a change. No doubt there would be a change in that. But then there are a lot of assumptions built into it. Otherwise, it is more or less of an academic debate, I believe.
Thank you for bringing this assumption element into it. Ever since the right to privacy judgment and these happenings and people becoming more aware of their applications and the permissions that they're taking, has there been an empirical research on privacy and how people look at it from the Indian context, which is relevant to our society right now? We do not have the evidence. We do not have the research to back it. Right now, what I am saying, you are saying is our statements, unless it is backed by hardcore proof and we can show that people are aware. Otherwise, people are going to twist the truth to whichever way fits them.
I'll give you one empirical evidence.
Yeah.
Whenever I install an app, leave aside me as a data point.
Yeah.
Whenever I install an app or I install any application on my laptop or anywhere, there are lots of terms and conditions.
Sure.
And at the end, it writes, I agree.
Right.
And what do? I agree. So who reads through those? There might be a lot of privacy issues.
Yeah.
It asks me access to my SMS.
This is again tying back to what Anand was trying to say. If you see entire governance or implementation of privacy or obligation of privacy, if it's a human, one individual human, as your target, then probably you would have a lot of those discussions. Okay? People are not culturally aware, people doesn't care, they want to trade their privacy. But collectively, if you want to take a decision, and when you talk about collectively, you talk about experience of so many people, right? And in that sense, one individual may not be aware. They may not have evidence whether he's aware or not aware. But for the larger society benefit, you need to be taking care of privacy. You need to be doing something of privacy. So in that case, if you are looking privacy as a collective phenomena in a country like India, and it will bound to become a collective phenomena. In that case, then we are saying that government assume the responsibility. So we are saying that rather than relying on a user for his privacy action, let government take a responsibility of the privacy. And that's why then the entire privacy expectations and enforcement mechanism can be looked at from that sense. I mean, for example, in case of European Union, is the same phenomenon. Although individual in European Union may not be very much privacy aware, but there the collective importance of privacy is such a important where the responsibility of a privacy protection is been taken by a government organization, right? So for example, each European Union has a data protection authority. right? And it has a power. So you empower that data protection authority with a lot of those criminal investigation or criminal penalty or civil penalty. So when you're looking at the collective way of implementing privacy, and in case of US, it is very little bit different, where they have the SRO mechanism. For example, people are free to do everything. If somebody found some problem, then there's some FTC kind of regulator will come into picture. They will investigate and they will say that, yes, these companies failed to do something in this area. And in that case, they may not enjoy as a privacy as a fundamental right, but they will definitely enjoy some consumer specific right. And consumer rights are not fundamental right in many of the countries actually. So such a way of implementing the power privacy policies, and there are a lot of diversity that is being seen in these two, and these are primary two things. So US is a more individualistic kind of a center, and individual has a lot of control, but that game is also changing now. HIPAA, high tech has brought a lot of those privacy expectation as a collectivistic element. But across the globe now, it is increasingly becoming government assume the responsibility. Yeah. So there are 120 plus countries has been now defining or revitalizing or retrofitting their privacy legislation. Only because they understood that it is a societal phenomena and people, an individual. Individual, even if it is very advanced like us, we are mostly coming from the educated background and we understand the subject. Every time that we share information, we may not have privacy sense of mind, right? We may not have the privacy frame of mind itself. So there is a something called as a cognitive effort somebody has to put to take decision of privacy.
So here, right? I would pause and throw the question to you. So we've talked about the role of the government. We talked about the issue of how people are having difficulties reading the privacy notices, the terms and conditions, and comprehending. In this whole ecosystem, what is the role of the industry, of the businesses, how they can fit in into this whole debate? Can they take actions to reduce this cognitive burden which Vinayak talks about? Can proactive action be taken? Are organizations taking these proactive actions? What can we do? As an industry body, as just spirited citizens, what can we do on our end to facilitate this happening? So what? Yeah, Aswati.
Yeah.
Wait, there is a question.
The thing is, I just wanted to highlight one of the other things of the earlier discussion that was pertaining to the nicety of the difference between privacy and secrecy. Emotionally, if you see, I'm talking from the cultural background. Emotionally, we are slightly softer vis-a-vis many others. So we are at times very inquisitive in asking more questions on the personal front, and at the same time, we are take pride in sharing our personal information. But that is more to do on a one-to-one basis. See, you connect with somebody and you tend to give bit more information because we don't have that question mark saying that, whether this guy is a threat. Vis-a-vis many other Western cultures. Now, coming back to the regulation part, the thing is the principle of, purpose, which is getting sort of, misused. I give the information to the school or to the bank or to whoever the service provider, I am giving it with a purpose. The problem comes is when that information gets misused without my concern or without my concurrence or, without my information. So that is the concern where we are looking for some third party. Maybe in this context, we are talking about government coming and playing a role. Now, again, from the Indian perspective, the second part of the question was the cynicism that we have, when we talk about regulation. GDPR, fine, that's okay. But I'm talking if we have to have a regulation within our country, we do have some regulations, but, the implementation gets into, sort of sideline. And, and there is a difference between government defaulting or government agencies defaulting and the private agencies defaulting. There is a difference between the two. So how can that get, sort of addressed? So probably I thought these two things I wanted to bring it to the fore.
Yeah, I think important thing, but first of all, we'll hear.
We'll take that and we'll talk about them together.
So in the context of what Anand and Vinayak were both saying, Europe had a socio-political situation which demanded that the citizens were given the rights that they are getting right now or has been enhanced to be provided with by the organizations. But agreeing to what Anand was extensively pushing on, in India, we have to first make the citizens aware of what they have to exercise. Though the IDV index is growing, we should also look at the gap of the population or the percentage of the population who is more aware or is more advanced in terms of a different thought process evolving in the culture. Maybe a few decades down the lane, we would be in a scenario where we would also demand for a right. It's my purely my thought on it. But then at this point, if we are giving a regulation to the society as comparable to GDPR, where the data subject is the center of it all, I think it would be rather helpful to enable the organizations to do that by default, rather than trusting the data subjects with the decision of whether or not they should be given the rights and the transparency that they are expecting in a privacy preserving culture and scenario. So imbibing this into the culture cannot happen through awareness, is my take. Rather, it should happen as a result of a regulation coming into place and then becoming more equipped with tools to take that into account.
I think this is very important distinction that we need to understand. So we all got right to vote, right? Universal right to vote in 1940s itself, right? And that was like, nobody waited that key people should be politically so much aware to take the decision that whom they voted. And that is why when you look at privacy as a collective phenomena, then you rely on, because the comprehension of privacy is for even advanced user is very difficult. And if you want an individual to be aware about the privacy and he take a decision to protect his privacy, that's very far-fetched kind of expectation from an individual, right? An individual citizen or a resident of the country. So that is why you need intervention, regulatory intervention, to set up that culture of respecting privacy. It's not a, it may not be right a culture of privacy in a citizens of the country, but setting up the regulation to set up the culture where you respect the privacy of an individual. So that's the difference between if you look individual as a center point for the privacy legislation or society as a collective point of the privacy legislation. There's something more that you talked about is with the government and private, basically. That is how I think this data protection regulation talked about that. I think, Anand, you can just...
Before we go into that, yeah. I have a different opinion on the socio-cultural readiness of India. So we have this brilliant document, the Constitution. It's a breathable document which moves with the times. And the court, the apex body, the learned people there have the knowledge to make an assessment, an accurate assessment of what the socio-cultural position is and where they see the country going. And they chose to recognize the existence, socio-cultural existence and the need to protect privacy as a fundamental right, not just a legal right, but raising it to the level of a fundamental right. I believe that itself is the beginning and the recognition of socio-cultural acceptance of privacy in India. Yeah.
Privacy is a fundamental right provided to this all citizen of India from long back, but we need so much time to interpret it properly. And
That is true, but sometimes you need to explicitly mention that.
So I think the debate started right now is because right to privacy has been recognized. There is no mistake, the right to privacy existed since a long time back. But the problem was its existence was recognized in other spheres of privacy. The privacy is a bigger concept. We have territorial privacy, we have communication privacy, we have with respect to surveillance, monitoring, all of these things existed. But the express recognition of informational privacy and data privacy, recognizing the harm that can come from misuse of data to the individual, that is where the distinction
just
comes.
To add,
that is to start the journey.
Just to add, I think, Ropa, on that part. So European Union, every 4 years, they assess the country. They have assessed India, and most 3 reports are already been there. I'm not sure whether they are public or not, but we got the copies of those reports. And everywhere, last 3-4 reports I had been checking up, the everywhere significant portion, so this is advocacy assessment in the country, significant portion has gone in terms of whether country recognizes privacy as a fundamental right or not. Mm-hmm. And they're saying there is a lot of rationals and lot of case laws which can tell us that it is going in that direction. It is probably respecting the privacy as a fundamental right, but it has not explicitly came out. And that explicit award of data of the privacy to the people of the citizens of India had happened last year.
Correct.
So it's a formal recognition and formal acceptance by our entire society that privacy is a fundamental right.
Correct. Here, this particularly privacy regime stood, you know, 3-4 years back because of data, is India a data safe country or not? And then Aadhaar come into the picture, and lots of question coming to the biometrics data, which is very sensitive data. But till date, industry is collecting lots of biometrics from the people for the attendance system, even before Aadhaar collecting it. Till date, this biometrics of iris and thumbprint is used for the attendance or critical area access, but people are not that much, you know, asking for, or there are not so much question in the mind of the data subject, where my biometrics going, how it is sitting. Once I'm moving out of the company, how company is actually forgetting me. Secondly, when nowadays all the organization are automatic, lots of things and lots of artificial intelligence is actually get created. So any employee or any critical employee leaving the organization and he or she leaving a virtual me or on the company, and how company is removing that virtual me, because that is a very sensitive data which is having the entire behavior, and how they are actually you know, going to impact each individual. That's how private sector, government and individual, that is the people of the country, needs to work in a collaboration to address that problem.
Yeah, means I think these are the discussion now, this is one scenario that you talk about. There are many scenarios the discussion will be applicable, and I think those scenarios need to be qualified to check how overall privacy is applied here and how there are different subject matters of privacy applies to this particular thing. And then when this different subject matters of privacy start influencing this way of collecting information in organization, then the as we talk about, key regulation will make them accountable and liable for the privacy. That's why they will take action in initial go. Gradually, employees will also become aware about the privacy and they will start asking the question about the privacy. But at this point of time, the more approach is like putting together regulation, and then that regulation would make their people accountable and liable, and obligation are set up for that, and that's why they will take some initial action.
Right.
So I think, but then another means actually we probably need to reflect on that question, applicability to the public sector and private sector, because that is also ties back with the discussion about Aadhaar and government use of information. But before you start talking about that, I think the Women and Security session is just starting now, another 5 minutes. So those who are interested to attend that, they will be, they request them to be going to the next hall, which is hall number one. So now, coming to the key question that he raised in terms of expectation of privacy and the different set of information organization, although privacy try to depend certain relationship, certain role, like data control, data processor. So that's a very important, interesting discussion of privacy in terms of a role. But now, government and private organization, and is there a distinction? What are the distinctions basically?
So there are different approaches, like we see in Canada that they enacted two different laws to deal with this situation, processing by public entities and processing by private entities.
Yeah, I think it's okay now.
Is it okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's one approach, that we create different laws for people, for different stakeholders, and we regulate them through these particular legislations.
other approach is that we create a comprehensive privacy law and have horizontal application around that privacy law. So horizontal application implies that the law will be applicable equally to the government entities as well as your private entities, bringing everybody into the fold.
Yeah, so this is important discussion and some of the concerns that we have about the government use of data. In fact, initial concerns of privacy was around government's ability to collect and process information and use that information for unintended purposes. For example, there had been some cases recently which talked about how the data of one application is being shared with political parties as well. So such a use of data by government authority had been a very important discussion matter for a subject of privacy. And now definitely this data protection white paper talks about privacy should be horizontally applicable. So there will be some functions of government, for example, investigation or surveillance or national security or some other areas or other functions basically or objectives or purposes where the expectation of privacy may be a little bit compromised or maybe a little bit scaled down, but not for across for each and every transaction. It should be very selective. It should be very process based and procedural based. For example, there is very interesting discussion which is happening. The law enforcement bodies, when they go to an organization for a criminal investigation, usually they have a habit of seizing all the assets available, right? So they will seize hard disk, they will seize the computer, they will seize the laptop, they will seize the mobile devices as well. And they do it for investigating a particular crime. But that will also breach a lot of privacy expectation because they will also see many other personal information and that may not be necessary for the investigation they have been doing. So how to make the investigation process privacy compliant is the new discussion. And people are even now thinking about making forensic technology which can be privacy enabled privacy technology. Surveillance was one of the important thing. Now US basically is PRISM and this all of those Snowden discussion. They tell us how the national security effort they can also be adhering to some of the privacy expectations.
So now surveillance is not just a particular government snooping or carrying out surveillance monitor activities. So it's not just restricted to the governments carrying out surveillance activities on their citizens or the residents within the country. Now it's countries snooping on other countries. So this particular aspect brings all these issues of all these calls for localization and data sovereignty of law enforcement, surveillance, and how we can protect the Indian citizens or residents or the government themselves from surveillance from another foreign entity.
Yeah, I have one question on data localization.
Yes.
Okay, so what is the view in India about the data localization, the data that will be collected in India first? First, it will be held here, then it will be transferred to the MNCs, or how it is being treated, unlike China and Russia?
So there are three schools.
I think let's hear to him as well, and then we'll try to...
I just want to ask, how does law protect the people who doesn't understand signing up for free services, who don't understand what terms and conditions they are signing, especially the kids or the guys who are illiterate. I think a lot of things are being now pushed to the consumers as free, but they collect data which is inappropriate, and some of the side effects of sharing information is not known to these people, especially the kids. There is no law which protects that, under certain age, the data should be protected or so. That was my comment.
So there are two different things. One is on a localization, another is on localization. We will definitely want to a little bit spend more time on that, and then we'll come to this question.
So there are three essentially approaches. First, we don't localize anything. We believe in free flow of information, and we, as an industry, and we've seen especially the IT industry has seen over the years the benefits of cross-border flows of information. Any form of restriction of cross-border flow of information is essentially is bad for the economy or the domestic market. because essentially we're talking about integrating with a global digital market. So that is one approach. Second approach we see is that recognizing the efforts of the headaches that the law enforcement agencies face, we should have at least some sort of localization. We should have copying, mirroring, but we allow free flow of information. Information would flow, but the restriction would only be, if you can call it a restriction or a cost, would be that you keep a copy here. Third, and the most dangerous form of localization that we encounter is exclusive localization. The kind we've seen emerge in China and a few other geographies, where we talk about exclusive localization for a particular category of data, or exclusive localization for all kinds of personal data, not allowing for any cross-border flow of information. That is the most dangerous situation that I can imagine. And these arguments are being taken by a few people, few of them fueled by the need of the law enforcement. And the other argument that I see a lot, and I would like Nayak's opinion on that as well, is what's your opinion on exclusive localization and domestic market development? Does it actually translate into India developing or making use of the data that we have? Is this a fair assumption? Is it a fair leap to make?
Yeah, so before coming to that, my basic fundamental question to you is, usually we give this reason, right, this instance where we say that India is a society where we tend to share information to our fellow passenger, right? So that's the usual example we always hear. Somebody in flight, somebody in railway, train, we tend to share the information. And then people say that we don't have the culture. But if you go to any other part of the globe as well, and people, fellow passengers which meets you, they also share that information with you. But there is a definitely difference between that way of exchanging information and a privacy concern. I would definitely have a problem to share the information to my neighbor than sharing that information to somebody which is my fellow passenger in a train. Because he will get away with his way and I will also go with him. So whatever he shared, it will remain there. Whatever I shared, that will remain there. He will not use that information to connect the dot, right? Whereas if there is somebody near to you who already has a lot of information about you, they get a new piece of information about you. Is that not risky? That is more risky as compared to the information that is being shared to somewhere distant from you. For example, if there is a something called the local media, social media application. So there are a lot of those neighborhood social media applications are coming. So I have a lot of problem on those in terms of privacy, because there are a lot of things that they know about me. And on the top of that, they know a lot of those information will be put in the local social media. So localization basically fundamentally goes against the privacy. Because, for example, imagine a smart city applications, right? So all of those cities which will be automating everything and connecting digitally everybody, and all of us, we are generating the information. If somebody locally start monitoring that, your cooperator start monitoring that, your local law enforcement guard is start monitoring that, then that will create a lot of privacy problem for us, right? For example, there was a case, somebody must have looked at that case, locally store information, local access to information would create a lot of problem for the privacy. In fact, there is a good privacy practice which is coming in, is if you really want to monitor your employee, and people are monitoring you through UABA kind of application, then let's not have internal employee monitor your employee. Internal resource monitoring employee. So outsource that particular monitoring, remote monitoring, and do that monitoring remotely. Because localization creates a lot of problem for the privacy. And same if you extrapolate to the national level, any attempt to localize the data in India would give a lot of those tools to the local agencies basically to compromise your privacy. So as an individual, I may not have a problem with somebody out there in US monitoring me, because they are not bothered about whether I support any this political party or that political party. But some local cooperator knows that I have this inclination to this party, then that will definitely create a lot of problem for me. So this is a basic fundamental discussion of localization, and that doesn't really, so data privacy legislative action shouldn't really talk about localization. You need localization for various different reasons that Anuman talk about for law enforcement, you talk about localization for that purpose. But when you talk about privacy, you really don't talk about localization. Is it the right proposition?
I have one question, since we are on the topic of localization. See, most of the IT and BPS companies in India and more so in Bangalore, we operate in a virtualized environment. We are accessing data stored in the US, in Europe, through Citrix or VDI or SDOD, these kind of platforms. Yet these all privacy laws and all apply to us. And I just want to also talk something about the format of information. Often when we talk about privacy, we are more so thinking about text or some system which we can visually look at, right? So I also want to ask you all your views on voice. Voice might be capturing some personal information. It might be stored locally in a server in India, in our on-site premises, in our company, or it might be streamed through a virtualized environment, as I was saying earlier. So I wanted to...
I think this is, you brought very important point. So until now, voice, we only thought about voice-based authentication. But that's not true, right? Alexa or Google Home that we interact with. So imagine any system that we work with, right? Any software system that you work with. So we browse. Yeah, we browse, we enter data, or we take some action, whether submit or any button is there, we take action. There are three things we are doing, right? And entire these three things can be now done by voice. You can browse by voice. You can take some action in terms of submit or something by voice. You can send the command on voice. And third part is even you can enter data. You can talk and the data can enter. So somebody can translate into the text and the data can be entered in that one. Or the data itself can be in voice form. And whenever required, people will use that voice form, convert into text and use that for processing. Going forward, you may not require to do even voice to text processing. It could be voice to voice processing itself. That could be a possibility. So in this, so what it tells us, ki entire infrastructure in coming 2-3 years of time will become voice-enabled infrastructure. Everything that we see as application would be voice-enabled application. And this voice has two things. One is action it takes. So that also is a personal, lot of personal thing will be there. Your voice itself is a voice, right? And that voice can be recorded as well. And somebody can, with or without knowing you, capture your voice sample and can misuse that against you as well. So when you talk about the personal, definition of personal information, it doesn't really, at this point of talk about this kind of thing. It does talk about simplify the definition as a personally identifiable information. Is your voice individually identify you? Probably yes. The voice can be identifiable information. Any sample of your voice can be identify you, can identify you. So it could be identifiable information. So then that should attract all of those expectations of privacy as it attracts for PII. So such a discussion will be the hemisphere of the discussion coming forward. And probably the privacy discussion will be shaped up because of all of this thing in coming forward. We'll also discuss on some of those parts which will be creating some challenges for the privacy. Voice is one of the important way of challenging the current paradigm of the privacy. You have something, sir. Can you move the mic there? We have some slides for GDPR also, so we'll...
So we're starting wide, then we'll go...
We are talking about the people and their information. Hmm. Now we are in the world of Industry 4.0, we are talking about information of machines. Hmm. Because they talk to man and for machines as well. So talking from that perspective, let's take an example of the industries which are coming up in different, including the smart cities, where the machines talk to each other. So how government is playing its role in safeguarding this information. Because I see, for example, I take a simple example of state electricity boards. Any of the state has their own electricity boards, and they have their own generation units. And also we have a national level generation units like NTPC, NHPCs. So I'm just taking an example, like if they think this information of their generation, their machines information going out of them is a threat for them. So then it's like a localization of the data. So they lose a lot of advantages of not providing this to the supplier who is actually can evaluate and provide a better capabilities for them. On the other side, there are also threats that this can be misused. So what is the role of government in doing this, setting of this boundary? Are they, what level they are going deeper in to protect this or ensure these problems being addressed?
Yeah, so I think this is again taking this discussion. So we talk about voice, but now we are talking about many attributes, personal attributes that will be collected. So people say that if you are using only desktops and laptops, 50 of your different attributes can be captured. If you are using mobile, 100 plus attributes can be captured. But imagine everything will become a, or everything would have its own digital twin. For example, if you have fridge in our house, it will have digital identity of that particular fridge. So then because of those things, there are a lot of those new attributes that will be adding to that. So because of IoT, an individual would record so much of the different kind of its attribute. So you consume a particular power in a day this way, and during the course of the day, consumption pattern is this. That itself can become a personal information of you. So definition of personal information and would have to really deal with all of those kind of scenarios.
Yes.
And you have to find a way. For example, until now there are three key definitions available. One is, with that information, there is a 100% surety that this is a person. That's identified information. There's another identifiable information. So we talk about voice will become identifiable information. There's a reasonably identified information. So which definition basically will come?
Can you just elaborate a bit on what, how the identifiable and is distinct from reasonably and
Yeah, so I'm sure ki most of the privacy law talks about identifiable information, right? So any information which probably a little bit effort that you take and you reach out to the individual. But there could be, so that could be identifiable information. By looking at that, there is no 100% guarantee that this is that individual with that information. That's identifiable information, and with a little bit effort, you can reach out to the individual, right? But there is a reasonable identifiable information as a definition as well. There could be one data set available with you, and with some effort, some kind of work and maneuvering, you can reach out to an individual. So that's a reasonably identifiable information.
So essentially it is the attribute itself being an identified piece. Say for example, just my license itself can directly identify me. There is no doubt about it. That is my personal data. Identifiable, and when we talk about reasonably identifiable, we're talking about different attributes. We're talking about different attributes about an individual. Say for example, my voice, my characters, how I walk. You combine that information, and the moment you can link it back to me, Anand Krishnan, it becomes personal data. So now this is come in recognition of the technology evolvement and how we can link information and profile individuals, how we can create a profile of an individual.
Yeah, coming back to the point I was discussing, okay, what I understand from Anand that keeping this as an abstract, keeping this as a categories or attributes, not connecting them together to build actually a twin of a particular person or a machine, it's fine. The moment I connect all these dots.
Moment you are reaching out to individual with that attribute, then it becomes personal information.
Yeah.
Means you will attract the obligations of personal information on you if there is a possibility of reaching out to individual with that set of information.
Yeah.
The possibility is very, it depends completely on the context and the capacity of the organization holding the information. We have these other sets of information available.
But the problem in current context, if you knew one small piece of information, a lot of other information is available. You can connect with that and you can you can identify information, identify a person. So there would be definitely very less piece of information which will not assure that you will able to reach out to individual. So increasingly the space is getting shrinked.
Right.
So means every set of information which has something to do with the person probably will take you to the person. And that's why that space is really shrinking. And increasingly identifiability of information because of the big data, artificial intelligence, and all of those possibility of collecting information from all of the sources. So that space is definitely shrinking. So that also tells us the coverage of privacy law. Until now they have been talking about identified or identified information, but that coverage of privacy law will expand to each and all of those information because that information piece will be in a way reaching out to individual. So expansion of the extent of the privacy law will significantly grow in the coming future because of the use of big data or artificial kind of intelligence kind of technology, because profiling and identifying an individual with even a pin code of an individual's address can help you to reach out to an individual with so much of the surety. So that is where the law would basically extend its reach to the whole set of information that can potentially be a personal information.
So we'll stop here. Now we will move to a narrower set of discussion. We'll talk about GDPR. And we will discuss not just information about GDPR and how the articles apply and what is all there, but we felt a great need, Vinayak and I have been discussing how there was no research around how it's impacting India.
You have something? So we discuss about the impact of GDPR. Somebody raised that, right? So probably next 30 minutes we'll spend on that.
Yeah.
How GDPR is impacting we as a country. And I think some of the slides that Anand will be taking you through, largely the impact of GDPR on an Indian context. So this is an effort that we put together for last 2-3 months with the help of Dulight, and we'll be trying to present it to you to take your views on them.
So I'm not going to keep it a very general explanation of GDPR. Everybody has attended some workshop or seminar around GDPR. I won't go through that loop again. So I want to discuss GDPR just from these parameters. We'll add another parameter when we talk about the survey result. We will discuss the implications for cross-border flow of information and how it ties in with trade for India with the European Union. So for the scope of application, you have material scope. We've been discussing right now. It's great that we're segueing right into it. The material scope of GDPR is personal data. So what personal data is, it is information which is identified or identifiable information. There is reasonable effort used on my part. As soon as I combine those individual attributes, I can link it back to the individual. And as soon as I link it back to the individual, it would become personal data. So tying into this whole discussion we are having right now, and how this law is a very technology advanced law. So from this, it is visible that it is taking into computing powers the recent of the evolution of the computing powers that has taken place, and how the organizations are carrying out their real recognition of how they're carrying out their processing activities. But what it does is it also removes certain ambiguities around certain things being personal data or not. There is no more guesswork around. It calls out that online identifiers such as IP addresses, unique device IDs, cookie identifiers. So these are particular identifiers which have been called out as personal data. So there is no debate around it. They put it in the scope. There is no interpretation to it. It is right there. You have to treat it as personal data. Location data has also been added to the definition of personal data. But what I find fascinating is at how it ties up with our discussion that we're having about identifiability and linking back to the individual is de-identified or pseudonymized data.
Essentially, we are removing a certain identifiable attribute from a particular data set, so the individual cannot be directly identified from it. But it is not an irreversible process. There's a possibility the data set is somewhere, I can bring it into the picture. Again, I can identify the individual. So it remains within the scope of GDPR, it remains personal data. But what happens if this de-identification process is done through means which are irreversible? Then it becomes anonymized data. Anonymized data is outside the scope of GDPR. So this is the easy part, trying to understand what personal data, personal information is. Everybody has understood it in some capacity or the other. The problem comes when you talk about extraterritorial application or the scope of GDPR. The easy portion is GDPR applies to EU companies which have presence in the European Union. You have an entity functioning there, it can be a subsidiary branch, doesn't have to be the HQ itself. If you have a presence, it applies. No questions. But the problem comes, it has been discussed earlier on in our discussions when we talk about how a country feels the need to protect the interests of its citizens and its residents and extend the law to an outer or a different geography. This is where the extraterritorial application of GDPR comes in. Extraterritorial application of GDPR applies essentially in two instances. First is if I am offering targeted goods and services irrespective if there's a transaction involved in it or not. If I'm offering targeted goods and services to an individual who is within the European Union, then GDPR applies. Second instance is if I am carrying out certain monitoring activities, then does not matter if it was any targeted goods or services which were being delivered. By virtue of me carrying out monitoring activities, GDPR applies. The two questions that you should come back to me and ask me is, what is this targeting? What does it mean to offer targeted goods and services to individuals? And what is this targeted monitoring the behavior of individuals? To simplify, this is something, so GDPR just formalizes many of the judgments which the European courts have come out over the years of certain instances where they have sought to extend the scope of GDPR to different countries. These are these instances. This is purely from an online perspective. Think of it from an online perspective and the businesses and the services that you're offering under the to the European Union, essentially. Does your website have these things? An international phone number on the website for contact purposes. What is your domain name? Is it a global domain name? Is it .com? Are you using country-specific domain names like France or etc.? Another important portion here is the language translation. Not everybody in the European Union speaks the same language. So targeting becomes very important if you're targeting or if you're offering services in a particular language. If I'm offering, again, taking the example of France, this comes from a case called Yahoo versus Lycra, where Yahoo was pulled into court by a student association, a Jewish student association, for selling Nazi memorabilia on their website. Now, Yahoo's contention was that I am a global player, I offer services to everybody in the world, why should I submit myself to your jurisdiction? The court said, whenever an individual accesses the Yahoo website, this particular page, the page is displayed in French. It is available in French. Whatever advertisements are available on the website are in French. So there is an intention on your part to enter the stream of commerce of France through transacting with citizens or residents in that country. So there is a formalization of that requirement. If your website is providing options for currency conversions, you are accepting euros.
So all of these are like, if there is something that you are doing to target European citizens in Europe, or you are resident in Europe, this is very important. In Europe, then probably there is applicability of the GDPR. Okay. So, and then so many things can be coming. So, for example, there's an intent. So you are providing conversion from euro to rupees, for example. Means there is an intent that you have that you definitely want to target European resident basically. If there is something that you are providing in terms of your website, you are the website and you are providing translation to France, means definitely you definitely have some intent to target the European resident. And that's why anything that you do intentionally to target a resident in Europe, that will probably make you applicable to the GDPR.
I think there's still more clarity in this regard to this particular aspect of offering goods and services.
Can you pass the mic here, please?
Yeah, there's a question. Yeah.
There are many colonies even in Africa.
Good point.
Which have French as their language, you know, spoken language, or national language even there.
Great.
So how do we distinguish?
So you look at the other parameters.
Sorry?
You look at the other parameters.
Achha, okay. So should it be collectively having all this or it is in isolation? I mean, should it be one qualifying or all should qualify?
All of these things need to be taken into consideration.
Yeah, Miss, but it's not and condition. It's a primarily or. But then if we are failing into one, then apply others as well. Any of these things, if you do, you qualify. And if you are challenging that, then other becomes an important part.
So you remove that particular requirement. Are you falling under the other ones or not?
No, for example, English. See, English is spoken in India. I mean, predominantly all the advertisements come in English.
Yeah.
So, I mean, but still, you know, we are not part of EU.
Yeah, but that's, I think these are common sensical things. So English will not attract any this kind of thing which they talk about. So what is happening, this
the
applicability
domain name will become very important
is the use case or the case laws which is getting created. So they are trying to define the scenarios. What do you mean by targeting? And they will still be proven, for example, you may be doing something in a French language, but you are targeting African. If you are reasonable evidence of that, they will still be okay with that one. So these are likely conditions where they will say you are targeting the European resident and with a specific intention of targeting them. So this will be determined by the case law basically.
So this is by no means an exhaustive list.
It is not definitive as well.
The key word is the European resident.
Yeah.
European resident in Europe.
That is the key word.
Resident, that's why become a very important word.
Right. European
if European citizen coming in India.
Holding the passport.
Yeah. So we are dealing with many situations. For example, somebody has a website, a furniture website. Somebody is providing roaming services to Europe. Somebody providing insurance policies to NRI citizens. A lot of those scenarios are now getting tested against this one.
And what if the organization is maintaining two versions of website? Like one especially for European citizens.
But entity is same, right?
Yeah, entity is same.
So entity. But entity for that particular version of website has to comply with GDPR.
About how they are targeting the citizen.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
there is no presence of that organization, but they are enabling.
Yeah,
a
this
portal,
these are primarily somebody
applicable.
Which doesn't have presence.
Correct.
And if you want to make them liable to GDPR,
correct.
So this is extraterritorial effect. Outreach or reach of the regulation because organizations sitting outside will target your residents.
So there is still some ambiguity around what would tantamount to monitoring of behavior of individuals. But again, these are instances in which the court, European court, has recognized that it would mean monitoring behavior. Online behavior-based advertising, many of them might not be applicable to maybe operation of a certain organization, but all these instances have been recognized by the court. So we're looking at location tracking in mobile applications. Monitoring of wellness and fitness health data by wearable devices. I think this is a very major implication here. So now we've seen, yes. Yes.
And he
comes to India and he is staying here in one of the hotels and using the network there. So that means the monitoring of wellness, fitness and health data that is on his device will be going through that network, right? So plus his mobile data, if he's using that network of the hotel, will also go through the hotel network. So hotel anyway is probably saving that data somewhere. So how this will go into play?
So you will have to see again if it is to a European individual in the European Union.
In the EU is very important word here.
Yeah.
If it is not in the EU, this is really doesn't apply.
It's not going to apply if he's in India. There might be other markers under which it would apply, but that is a separate use case, separate situation. In this situation, it might. So resident in EU, that is the qualifying factor. Yeah. So that is why they say an individual within European Union, not a citizen within European Union. Which is important because the Indian law is looking that way as well.
Probably we will be, it will apply to us.
Yep. Yeah. There is not even time limit on residency right now. If you're transiting, it doesn't matter. If you're there, it will apply.
So, for example, in the case of harassment, you go to Europe and you file harassment, you not obligatory kind of a thing. So this kind of scenarios may come in the future. If you want to really...
No, my point was, there is no marker on it that you're resident for this particular point, this time period.
The residency is not really well defined.
Yeah.
Right.
It so can be a day, can be 100
days.
Whether
it is a day or a month or 3 months or 6 months or a year.
So it becomes a
so
bit
you
complex.
Go there for a one day and something is breached. So would you still,
So there is no, as such, there is a lot of ambiguity about the residency itself, the duration attached to it. Yeah, it will be. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Law of the land will apply.
So, yeah.
Stay in a hotel which is maintained by a European, then it is
The hotel is in India. Mm-hmm. It is maintained by anybody, does not matter. It is in India. Indian laws will prevail, not GDPR would come into the picture.
So GDPR is basically to prevent profiling of the European person staying in Europe. Is that correct?
For this particular instance, it won't be, but there might be situations where it would be, yes. I mean,
Indian entity, any business entity in India should be governed by all Indian law, sectoral law or the generic
that is
law.
That is true.
That is one of the part. Yeah. Now, where you are targeting a certain market, for example, lots of star hotels, they have a focused marketing team for the tourism purpose. They have, if they are focusing EU citizen and
they're applicable to GDPR.
Booking for all across the world. Because if you look at today's environment, you go to any of those hotels, this is coming kind of surprise to me. Even they are asking Indian citizen to sign the GDPR form.
Yeah, that's the funny story happening. So many of them are sending us a lot of those kind of document and notices telling that they are complying with GDPR, which is not really required, and those communications are coming. But this discussion is very important, and case laws will determine this more definitively. At this point of time, definitivity of this one is not much, but gradually it will evolve as well.
Let's
move forward because there is something that we need to cover. Because there are interesting data points that we have to talk about how it is impacting, GDPR is impacting India, because we have just 25 minutes
left
now.
If it's a situational-based question, maybe we can take it later on.
No, this is not situational-based.
Okay.
My question is, the GDPR implementation is just to prevent the individual profiling of EU person, or what is the intention behind this?
intention is to protect the fundamental rights of an European resident.
No, so if the European person is traveling to outside Europe, I can profile him very well. If I'm traveling to a hotel which has throughout the world, they have hotels everywhere, chain of hotels. I can travel to any hotel and they already have the data on me. Right?
Okay.
So, they can profile my food habit. They can profile whom I call from their landline. They can profile who comes to visit me. So, that profiling is anywhere taking place. And if I'm a European citizen and traveling throughout the world,
This sharing of data is an interesting point. I mean, that is something that...
Yeah, but actually, honestly, this discussion is important, but at the same time, we need to understand actual enforceability would happen in EU. So, although it is trying to make other organizations liable for the privacy, but at the end of day, it is saying that if citizen or any individual is in EU, they are in better position to do that, right? If you are in India, then Indian law will take care of that one. And that, then it will be conflicting, right? So there will be a lot of conflict which will happen. So what they are saying is, if you are offering something to European resident here in EU, then you have to obey this one. But something happens in India, Indian law, and that is true with other jurisdictional issues as well, Indian legal system will take care of that one. So at this point of view, it remains that, I'm not saying this is a very definitive answer, but it will also evolve in the coming future time. There can be some arrangement between country to country about the privacy enforcement.
No, there is definitely a need to do a research in the hospitality industry and GDPR.
Yeah.
I mean, if I can come across something, I'll send it to you. It's not a problem.
So let's go ahead because we have to now cover. Yeah.
So now our survey findings. So this survey is dedicated to only Indian organizations. In organizations operating in India, it may be a foreign entity, but operating in India. So, with respect to GDPR application, extraterritorial scope, we found this is a combination number of monitoring as well as offering of goods and services without having residence in the European Union, without having presence in the European Union. So, 23% of the survey participant organizations were subjected to extraterritorial application of GDPR.
Yes, even if they are not in EU, they have to comply with the GDPR.
Majority of the organizations had presence in the European Union, which wasn't a big surprise, but seeing that this number was pretty high was a startling revelation that the extraterritorial application is coming to India to this particular level.
Yeah.
So, this is the concept of a controller and a processor. I will not go in too much detail about it. I will just leave it at this particular instance. Determining the means, the purpose and the means of how the processing, why the processing is going to happen and how it is going to happen. If this is happening, it is a controller. If the processing is happening on the behalf of this particular entity, it is a data processor. Again, I hear this a lot, so collection does not mean this is a data controller. Collection can be done by the processor as well. It is only the power to determine the means and purpose. So with respect to this, the role that these organizations are playing with respect to GDPR, so the way we word it is we wanted to gauge their preparedness as well as their awareness around it. So one way to do that is that we say that you have direct liability under the law itself. If you do that, then you are a data controller. Subprocessors are purely contractual relationships which do not directly come under the scope of GDPR. But data processors have legal obligations under GDPR, such as records of processing, everything that you find in the obligations of processors. And they also have contractual relationships with the data controller for certain obligations. So we found that majority of the organizations fell into the third category. 51% of the organizations were data processors. So, participants, yes.
Can we have a simple example stating controller or processor so that we can clear out on the whole idea of this? Maybe, for example, if I'm a service provider, so where Google as my data controller or let's say processor, if they are fetching some data for analytics and giving me some service as an AdWords or something, or maybe giving some advertisements on my website. No. So how does
I will give you a great example.
Yeah.
You've used SurveyMonkey. Have you used SurveyMonkey? We actually used SurveyMonkey to do this one. So if you look at the privacy policy there, so whatever data that is being collected, whatever questions are being asked, how it is going to be processed is everything which is done by, say, for example, DSCI. DSCI is doing that. The determination, everything is being done by that. But the survey portal, SurveyMonkey, provides me these services of correlation and all of these things. But it's not going to provide me the service unless I let him or instruct it for a particular activity to happen. Me, in this instance, who has created the survey, is the data controller.
Okay.
SurveyMonkey is working on my behalf to provide me this service, is a data processor. Majority of organizations, say for example, your processing organizer, BPO, BPM operations, fall under the category of a data controller, data processor. So these are different grounds of processing mentioned under GDPR. You might be familiar with many of them. There are a few complex ones which I'll just briefly go over. Legitimate interest, in case you do not know, there are certain instances that qualify as legitimate interest. I would urge you to go through the working party opinion, where it clarifies that what needs to be done for a legitimate interest to be actually be legitimate. It should be clearly worded. There should be a balancing test which needs to be performed. And what would these instances be which can to qualify as legitimate interest would possibly be these situations. We have seen a major change from 2016 when it came out, the discussion was going on. Direct marketing was in this category. People were considering direct marketing to be a legitimate interest of an organization. But now we see that the narrative around direct marketing and processing is changing a lot. So if an organization is taking direct marketing as one of the pleas for legitimate interest under GDPR, I would not advise it. You're better off taking consent.
Yeah, but so simple interpretation of this one is, for something like a fraud prevention, if you're collecting data, then that could be legitimate interest and you may not require to take a consent in that case. Hmm. So that's the simple interpretation of this one.
But this is a balance.
One question. A very specific one, actually. In case of having a consent on storing data of any individual for giving some service, for example, if I'm a bank and there are some cookies that are to be stored from the browser pertaining to a particular customer in terms of like his location, whatever, and other cookies as well. So in this case, if like there's say a consent given to the customer that you can opt out of let's say a sessions cookie, which is basically termed for securing the session, the session management. So if the customer consents to get out of that thing which where you don't get that session cookie at all, so how do we go forward? It will
legitimate interest. It is in your legitimate interest to protect your network and infrastructure. These parameters can be exercised by you.
Okay. So we can overrule all
that. You can do that. Session cookies, you can do that. But persistent cookies for behavioral monitoring is doubtful. You cannot use legitimate interest.
Which is Google Analytics.
Yeah, so people use cookies to resell, right? So once you visit to any site,
correct.
Use a cookie to resell or sell something. So that is not something will come into legitimate interest.
Again, two parts of it. Like many of the financial institutions like banks as well use it for cross-selling. Some do it for direct targeted marketing. Hmm. So targeted marketing being a plus point of it, cross-selling to an irrelevant customer may be a downfall of it. So that's debatable. Thank you. Thanks.
So these are the different grounds that are mentioned, and we ask the Indian organizations which particular grounds that you usually take during a course of business. As expected, many of the organizations look at the contract or the performance of a contract, the data subject, as the most used ground. There might be other legal obligation, a particular government law is compelling that I carry out this particular processing activity. Say, for example, your money laundering and all of these prevention activities that you need to carry out might be compliance with certain legislation. In case of India, I would say the Aadhaar would also require your compliance for this requirement. 60% would rely on consent. So if you're taking consent, you need to make sure that your consent sort of looks like this. Otherwise, it won't be a consent under GDPR. Legitimate interest, 43%, which is a remarkable revelation. I did not think many good organizations would take this particular ground so early or in the process. I thought the consent would still be considered and the, Many organizations also mentioned a subject. Why vital interest is coming into the picture right now is because it was a because this particular law is a sector agnostic law, so our survey was also sector agnostic. We looked at different institutions, ITES, ITBP, and our different other organizations were also part of it. So healthcare services were also being considered in this survey. So in case of healthcare service providers, vital interest subject as a ground. Serving a public interest is again, it can point to lack of awareness or may some far thinking objective that I did not see foresee again. Government organization would. So I will, many. So we did sector-wise and we did lines of service-wise. So when we talk about special categories of data, I'll pull that in. So special categories of data is this particular kind of data you might have encountered or read about it, these different instances, generally considered as high risk of processing if you're carrying out, especially in case of large-scale processing of this information. So now we did a correlation with the lines of services and what kind of exposure that is happening to this with respect to this personal, the sensitive data. We found these particular numbers. Your health information processing, testing activities, application development, business intelligence, data management, finance, marketing, sales, intelligence, and analytics. So all of these lines of service were you making use of sensitive personal data or special categories of personal data. There is another sector-wise analysis that we have done, which will be made available when the report formally comes out. So it's a very comprehensive report. We looked at very different other correlations that we could carry out. Now this so with respect to special categories of information, consent requires a higher threshold. This particular action is known as explicit consent. So we asked a question about how do you actually carry out this process of getting explicit consent. So filling an electronic form in case of a written, handwritten form, data subject's actions being logged, sending an email, a declaratory statement on part of the data subject is widely accepted as a ground as explicit consent. An opt-in mechanism after a detailed notice. I would like to see how this mechanism takes place. Is it detailed enough to make it, it's a two-step process? Scanned documents carrying a signature, scanned document carrying a signature is by far the most, the best way probably you can do it, sure short way of doing it. So if you want to look at how you can carry out this activity, the survey was also intended to give you different ways in which you can carry out this process. This will be detailed in the full report when it comes out. So now there are different rights which are mentioned under GDPR. Notice is 13-14, then you have right to access, rectification, restriction, objection of certain kind of processing, restriction of processing, automated decision making, and right to data portability being one of the new ones, and data breach notification to a data subject in case it is of as soon as possible, if it is of a high interest, there is a high risk of injury to the rights of the data subject. With respect to data subject rights, it is one of the most compliance heavy requirements under GDPR. Many organizations are required to create very many processes and downstream processes. Collection of artifacts needs to be done to implement these particular data subject rights. So we asked them, starting with the biggest right, which is the right to access. Right to access is just not restricted to the access to the information, is a lot more. First things, what are the major challenges with respect to you are facing with respect to your data subject access requests? Many believe it is provided the information of the source of the data. Where did you get this particular data? Finding it within your organization, having visibility over the data itself becomes a major challenge. Reliance of third-party vendors coming into the picture, again, locating the data, visibility of the data. Access, assess the data collected directly. Now, another, some believe it's an overreach on part of GDPR to question or to have access to the logic behind
notification process. agreements. Now you're required to have anti data protection for data processing agreements. With respect to this particular whole thing, we ask organizations what changes do you see in your contracts? These things came up. So we saw many organizations saw or both saw that they would be many negotiations around sharing of liability. Talking about your agreement of data processors and they will sign to data control, you have not bothered much about diabetes. But now it's talking of 4% of the total revenue. That's why it will be having a lot of discussion, a lot of agreement, a lot of back and forth to sign those contracts. That's not definitely what we're doing. So these are just a few parameters when you talk about demonstrating accountability, the BPI and the data protection officer in place. And particularly only through the statistics or results of this for you. Steps taken is issuing a guidance to your organization how the BPI will be carried out. The survey. Second was guidance on identification of how much entails high risk processing. A mechanism to review the DBIAs and carrying out the cyclic process for carrying out the data protection impact assessment. You are required to carry out data protection impact assessment every 3 years according to the document, but as a best practice, it is said that you carry out it every year of the initiation of the new project. With respect to the data protection officer, we did a comparison of what the data protection officer, not the office, should look like, or the individual. Many of them think that they should have legal compliance, legal and compliance knowledge. Relationship and liaison is very important because you need to communicate with the data protection authority there and have an open line of communication with them. Risk management is also considered as also important and technical. Technical knowledge, architectural knowledge is also considered. Privacy by design as a concept has been given by GDPR. Many of you who attended our use cases for privacy workshop. Primarily, was focused on how we can start designing solutions for privacy, how we can incorporate privacy, re-engineer for privacy. A longer discussion on this would happen tomorrow. There will be a session on it. Time to design for privacy. So, this concept, be sure to attend that particular session. Now, tying it to the start of the discussion, when we talk about cross-border flows of information and tech implications, India being a great market, and many of the organizations viewing Europe as a great market, we ask them the question, what do you think the benefits of adequacy would be for India? Say, for example, India gets an adequacy status. So these responses came back. When you believe the EU facilities open up a business, you would open up businesses, rather the SMEs in India, operating in India, they can offer services there, they would increase in revenue. But some believe that it would not have a major impact. We saw what an
overall this new data protection regulation that we are in. So there is definitely a possibility for us to look at the adequacy strategy, and with that, and some of you must be understanding the meaning of adequacy status is to become something that European Union country. The data flow is easy there, and we don't have to sign the standard monitoring process. So it's very free flow of information that we come to the country. That will definitely increase a lot of prospects in our lot of market prospects in European Union for a lot of small scale engineering companies to look at the European geography as a market, and a lot of European sponsored organizations will also start thinking about outsourcing in India. This is a benefit that will come out of the adequacy.
So we ask them a question around what kind of preferred instruments they follow because India is not an adequate country. Many of them follow standard practice because RTP is that many organizations the context of the group schemes are using one guiding corporate rules as well. Because we have come across certain instances where there is distrust within the organization itself. They are not refraining, they are refraining from using PCRs and using standard contractual clauses, even in case of entire organization transfers. Thank you.
So this is like a survey we are supposed to get
larger survey document that is, will be put in by the some extent through that mechanism. The data controller through the processor would require representation being present in the European Union.
So it will be a subsidiary or maybe an individual or how can you say?
It can be an individual, it can be a firm which is representing you. It can be a representative essentially.
But so is it mandatory to have a representative?
Yes.
But if a company is processing the EU person data in India and doesn't have any representative in Europe,
B2C, right? Not in B2B. If you have client there, the your liability. So in that case, you may not have the representative identity. Discussion on GDPR. Although this report will have a lot of those insights available, but we are also talking and engaging with so many different organizations. So one go, there's a furniture aggregator in this country to somebody which is providing application, doesn't have anything, but there are some aspects that they are targeting to get in there to something which is even. Even there is a registry of India, right? Dixi, manager registry. So those registries are grappling key whether somebody from European Union has registered Indian domain, whether you should go give the GDPR protection or not. So this is very encompassing to all of different type of organization, and finding availability is very difficult part. And lot of learnings which are coming out of all of those interactions. And we'll keep sharing those learning in this kind of interaction that we have today. So, so the purpose of this discussion was discuss the privacy, the way it is coming in terms of regulation, discuss the political ecosystem which is evolving, social ecosystem which is evolving, at the same time look at society and individual at the center point. And even there was another workshop that we did some time back in Bangalore. When you talk about privacy, we should also think about how to solve the problem of privacy. So audit process, organization, is not only way to solve the privacy. Technology is also a very important way of solving privacy. In fact, privacy is a very greenfield subject where you can think about using technology to solve privacy. So there's another initiative of the ASA which talks about, we think privacy, think technology. And we are creating an ecosystem for people to understand the subject of privacy well. And those understanding should lead to them identify the use cases. And those use cases should help us to develop a technology for the purpose of privacy. So the industry building initiative of DSCI talks about how can we create more companies in this country which are privacy focused technology driven companies, and they are developing technology for the solving privacy. So a lot of those way the discussion of privacy can go. So this today's discussion we try to focus on the larger aspect of privacy and then try to bring you to the GDPR and the impact of GDPR in the country like India, especially the way we have been interacting with European geography. But there are some larger issues, larger problems that we will keep contesting. We would be interacting and engaging on those problems. We are hoping that data protection regulation draft bill will come soon, and that itself will give a lot of trigger for a lot of debates actually. Because any law is not only protection, it's a proposition. And sometimes those propositions can be contested. Sometimes those propositions may create a problem for a particular set of industry or larger set of industry. So we would have to see them, understand them, comprehend them, and probably look at how that is impacting us as an individual company and to the larger ecosystem as well. and see whether we can find a middle path for that. So that was the basic intent of this particular session, and Ananda and I put together some thought for this session. But the initial discussion and your interaction and your questions and those kind of observation, really very interesting for us to carry them to the discussion that we'll be doing around this new data protection regulation coming in. And we are hoping that will come soon, and we'll also get another opportunity to talk to you, because once the topic is available, the topic will be also required to be debated. So we have to also consult, engage, and give our comment back to the government. So that will be another opportunity created in Bangalore to talk to the community here if the topic comes in a coming 1 month's time. So with this, thanking you all. Probably this is an important key second workshop that in a day that we have been doing, and there are four panel workshops which are happening. So we definitely have a small discussion at 4:30 probably here, where we are discussing about the assurance mechanism that we are thinking at DSCI. So until now, the privacy is more organized to be not going to be talked about. But at the end of day, your application, your product, your thing like IoT things will be interacting, engaging with the consumer. And consumers' privacy will be breached by them. So we're trying to create some assurance mechanism and framework for looking at those websites, looking at those mobile applications, looking at those products and IoT things, and trying to evolve a kind of assurance mechanism. We will definitely want to discuss with some pretty people who are interested in those this discussion. And probably share what we are trying to think to take your views. If you are interested, please join us here at 4:30. We'll be continue 1 hour, we'll try to spend the thing that we have been building at a DSCI.
Just to get your feedback,
show
us what you have created and whatever
your opinions are, we have. Yeah. Same group, 4:30 that we are meeting. So with this, thanking you all. So we conclude this today's town hall for the privacy. And please join us tomorrow. So there will be a lot of discussion starting on the 8 in the morning. We are starting with some very interesting discussion about this. A lot of those discussions are happening. And from there to the evening, there are a lot of sessions which are coming in. And the entire discussion of platformization basically would be going through a lot of those kind of sessions that we'll be discussing. Just to before close, I think tomorrow today morning, if some of you were here in this discussion for the Palo Alto platformization and network security part, there was some survey form which has been circulated. If you have failed that, please submit it to me or ushers which are being in this zone. Thank you. Thank you for joining today.